Hello everyone and a very, very warm welcome to the Ikigai Law webinar on digital games and sports legal issues. My name is Neha Chaudhary and I was the moderator of this webinar. This is a recording of the live webinar which we conducted on the 24th of April 2020, which was a Friday. In this webinar, we covered four big legal issues. One, IPR, which was led by Aman Taneja and Vijayant Singh. Two, contracts and other issues with a particular focus on esports, led by Sarthak Doshi and Vishak Ranjit. Three, tax, led by Rajat Mittal. And four, digital payments, which featured a conversation between Arpit Gupta and Aparajita Srivastava. We faced some technical difficulties in our webinar on Friday, the 24th of April. So Aman and I have come together to record the introduction and the first few minutes of the webinar, which you will miss in the live recording. At some point, Aman will indicate to all of us when the transition takes place from this recorded video into the live webinar. We encourage our participants to ask us lots of questions using the chat box during the webinar. So the questions that you will see speakers addressing are the ones that have been received from various participants. Before we dive right in, for those of you that may not know about Ikigai Law, we are a tech and innovation focused law and policy firm. And we work in a whole range of different areas with an intersection with technology and a focus on innovation. Digital games and sports are, of course, a core area of work for us. There's a lot of writing that we do on a range of different subjects. Feel free to take a look at our website, www.ikigailaw.com. We're also available on social media, so you can find us on LinkedIn, Twitter, and Instagram. Thanks again for your interest. And with that, Aman, I'm handing this over to you.
Thanks, Neha. Just give me a second while I load the presentation. So thanks for the introduction, Neha. In this section, we talk about the intellectual property issues in digital games. And it's a fairly vast area. So we've narrowed down to three or four bigger issues that we'll be touching. So we start off with issues on the classification of games in the spectrum of intellectual property. Then Vijayan talks about how publicity rights interact with fantasy sports. Then he talks about this new concept of live streaming of digital games and how that interacts with the law. And in the end, we talk a little bit about the competition issues around esports and the amount of market power that game publishers have. So I'll dive right in. So a game, like a digital game is or a video game is the combination of multiple rights. It's the perfect sort of amalgamation of different IP. You have the audiovisual components, which is the musical work, the artistic work, the cinematograph film, and you also have the underlying computer program or the source code, which is a literary work for the purposes of copyright law. Then, of course, you have the brands and the franchises around these games. So that's an element of trademark law. And as we'll discuss later in this webinar, there are issues of personality rights. And so that's another form of IP, which is sort of which interacts with this world. So to start off with, I thought I'd take us through an example of a case which came up before the High Court back in 2008, which was Scrabble versus Scrabulous. And these days, during this time, this crisis, a lot of us have been staying at home and playing virtual games with our family, including something, including Ludo King, which is an online version of Ludo. So this was essentially an online version of Scrabble that these two gentlemen based in Calcutta had built. And Mattel took objection to that. And they sued them for infringement on a few grounds, including copyright infringement in the layout of the board, some design claims, and also a trademark claim over the brand Scrabulous. So there's an illustration of how different rights are at play in any game. And the court actually in this case held against Mattel on the copyright claim, applying something which is known as the doctrine of merger. Now, for those of you unfamiliar with this, copyright law seeks to protect original expression. It does not protect ideas, no matter how original. And this is known as the idea expression dichotomy. So, but in some cases, courts have found that ideas and expressions are so closely linked that giving protection over a particular expression will lead to a monopoly over an idea, which is not permissible under the law. So the court in this case found that the rules of the game Scrabble, and I mean the idea of Scrabble and its expression in the form of this board, were intrinsically linked, and granting protection over this would lead to monopoly over the idea of games such as Scrabble, and therefore against Mattel this claim. And we're not going to go into the rightness or wrongness of that. It's just illustration. But on the trademark aspect of the case, Mattel succeeded in its claim against the people who'd set up Scrabulous, and they were stopped from using the brand Scrabulous. They eventually ended up naming it Lexibulous, which you can still play today. And I think that's an homage to the amount of litigation that they had to go through around this game. But I thought it was a good illustration of the different rights which are at play in a digital game. So that's it from the recorded part, the re-recorded part of this session. What you see from now onwards will be what was captured live on Friday, the 24th of April. So let's move on. Now, the question I would like to sort of talk about is, does the law need to catch up? So the image on your screen, which you can see, is an image of a mod chip, which used to be used to jailbreak PlayStation 2s back in the day, which would allow you to play pirated discs on PSs. I mean, so there was an amendment to the law which brought in these protection of technological measures. So if you try circumventing a measure which has been built in to protect copyright, that would fall afoul of the Copyright Act. So the Delhi High Court in that case held against these shops in Ghaffar Market, and there was an injunction passed against them. But the relevance of this today is a bit questionable, in that since then the world has moved on quite a bit. I don't think there are issues around piracy in games in the same way anymore. And a lot of that has to do with how networked everything has become. Because of that, I mean, there is really no incentive to try and modding these games, because it's a little pointless. You can't really get the full functionality. So I'll move on now and hand it over to Vijayant, who's going to talk to us a little bit about the... there's one last issue. I mean, so there's these days the more common form of infringement is not really necessarily infringement, but there's a lot of issue of copycat games which come up every time there's a new sort of game. There's the example of PUBG and Free Fire. You have Subway Surfer and Temple Run. When Angry Birds was new, there was a lot of knockoff versions of Angry Birds sort of games which came up. And I think that's a question for really the industry to decide if this is where they want to focus their attention on. The WIPO at some point had recommended considering creating some sui generis rights for video games, which is distinct from like the underlying copyright. So that's maybe a conversation for later. I'll for now hand over to Vijayant, who's going to talk to us about fantasy sports and the publicity rights in them.
Thanks a lot, Aman. Am I audible firstly?
Yes, you are, Vijayant.
Okay, great. So as Aman mentioned, the topic I'm speaking about today relates to the use of the names of professional sports players, their likeness, their image in the context of publicity rights. Now, before we start, I'll quickly explain to everyone what fantasy sports are, to those in the audience that are not familiar. Now, fantasy sports cover those digital games where users assemble virtual teams of real players who compete based on stats derived from real-life performances in real-life sports games. Now, a good example of that is Dream 11. Now, what are publicity rights? these are a broad set of common law rights that vest in the individual's personality, and they usually protect two things. First, they protect a person's right to benefit economically from the use of their name, likeness, and image. And second, they protect a person from the harms arising out of the unlicensed use of their name, images, and such. Now, in this context, there are two issues that arise for fantasy sports operators. The first one, expensive and long drawn out court battles that are started by players on the unlicensed use of their name or images by fantasy sports operators. Second, the publicity rights, these create a greater licensing burden on fantasy sports operators because now they have to enter into multiple licensing agreements, not just with sports federations and leagues, but also with individual players. Many a times it's also not clear as regards to who they are supposed to license from, because sometimes players also transfer rights to sports federations. With regards to litigation, while there have been a number of important court judgments in that recognize the publicity right, they also link it with the right to privacy and also a individual's right to benefit commercially from the use of their personality, which is, you know, name, images, and likeness. Now, however, despite this, the position in India is still largely underdeveloped. So what does this mean for fantasy sports operators? In practice, it would mean that the name and images for commercial purposes would not be okay. Also, if the use of the name and images of players suggests endorsement by those players in the app, then again, that would not be okay. Aman, if you could just move on to the next slide, that would be great. But fantasy sports don't use names or images in a commercial manner or in a manner that suggests endorsement for the most part. Now, the use of player names and images in fantasy sports is largely for the purpose of identifying those players. Now, judgments and laws and statutes from different countries like the US, France, Germany support this position, saying that the use of names and images is okay if it's only for the purpose of identification, if it's only for the purpose of relaying real life stats and facts, or if it's for purposes that are newsworthy or editorial. This is also somewhat similar to the position in the Trademarks Act in India, where there are Section 30 exemptions for unlicensed fair use of trademarks for nominative or descriptive purposes. However, these exceptions are pretty much untested in the Indian courts, but it may be a good bet to say that if fantasy sports operators the use of names and images only for the purpose of identification and relaying real life facts derived from those real life games, we may have a lesser chance of having to pay any damages. All right. Now, moving on, the next issue that I will be touching upon, this relates to questions over rights on the ownership of user-generated content in digital games. While it's clear that game publishers own the rights over the game itself, the question is, who owns the user-generated live stream content? Is it the game player or is it the game creator? Legally speaking, this may be somewhat a gray area, but game publishers or game creators rather, they do unequivocally own the rights to the use of games, images, and the video content derived from the game through copyright law, meaning that they can use the Copyright Act to limit how their games are used in live streams. Typically, on the other hand, arguments put forward by gamers are that the use of the game is transformative in that it significantly alters the game or it adds a new creative expression to the game. They say this on the basis that gamers A, are playing the game, B, they are creating new content, C, they are commentary and reaction to it, which results in an end product that is somewhat or completely different from the original game. Now, gamers also in many cases create complex new avatars. Skins in PUBG would be a good example. In games such as Minecraft, you end up creating a completely new world each time you play. Now, these, although are a completely different set of ownership-related questions. On the other hand, gamers may also argue that perhaps maybe not in India, but they may argue that the use qualifies as fair use, meaning that the game is used for purposes in the live stream for research, comment, or critique, because they are live streaming the game and they are giving their commentary on it. But as I mentioned earlier, game creators can simply argue, hey, we own this property, this game is ours. And if you are saying any of this content is transformative, we say that it is still a derivative work over which we hold the rights as per the law. Although from a business perspective, I think game creators can and have adopted user generating streaming as a profitable area. And because this helps expand a game's user base, it also helps drive sales and also generate free publicity and advertising. And it also fosters and creates gaming communities and fan bases. There is also the possibility that there may be a market backlash and a game creator may suffer significant PR problems if they choose to enforce their rights against gamers and live streamers in a more aggressive manner. So in response to all this, we see that game creators are adjusting their legal policies, and the industry has come up with a bunch of different kind of licenses that allow streaming. Most prominent game creators will take a middle of the road approach where they will attempt to protect their IP. And on the other hand, they will also try to capture the benefits that live streaming can offer to them. But even in these licensing agreements, mostly game creators retain the right to remove any content that they don't agree with. And also they end up limiting the different sources and avenues of revenue generation for gamers. So all in all, they might be still somewhat some more of a balancing act that is required in this context. So all right, that's it from me, Aman. Aman will now take the conversation forward on licensing issues in esports. Aman, back to you. Aman, you're on mute. Aman, you're on mute right now.
Got it. Thank you. So I was going to talk about esports and some of the licensing issues that revolve around those. And I think we're a little pressed for time, so I'm just going to leave a quick thought out there. I'm taking the example of back in 2007 when the Indian Cricket League, which sort of started as a rival league to the BCCI's IPL, it was still the IPL hadn't started back then, but the BCCI did a lot of things in its power to try and stop this league from happening. Like saying that they'll ban players from playing for the country, so on and so forth. But the league still happened because nobody owns the game of cricket. But that the distinction with esports is that there is a game publisher who actually owns IP rights in the game, which a lot of people play competitively, for which there are tournaments. And this can lead to licensing issues. They could be licensing to a certain organization which they favor more, giving broadcasting rights to people they favor more, and keeping others locked out from entering into those markets of these games. So there are issues around this. Maybe Sarthak and Vishak in their next session will touch upon some of these things. And in the meantime, if you guys have, if the audience here has any questions, we'd love to take them. I'm stopping the presentation for now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vijayant and Aman. That was very, very fascinating. There are actually a few questions that speak directly to some of the things that you guys just talked about. If you look at the question, Aman, from, say, Mulkit, who owns, in case of GeForce Now or Google Stadia or Microsoft Game Streaming, in cases where, you know, the game is essentially viewed someplace else, it's rendered in one place, and the content might be owned by someone completely different. So what happens to gaming rights and licensing issues there? There are a couple of issues and questions around publicity rights as well. Can esports players claim publicity rights? There's another one before that from Sahana, where she talks about claims of damages. So could you address some of these, and then maybe we'll come back to Tanya's on the first sale doctrine.
Sure. That's a fair few number of questions. On maybe we'll start with Mulkit's, and I'll just, I think there has been a to a large extent, there's a lot of contractualization of copyright these days, a lot of it flows from what rights are given at the stage of the end user license agreement, and thereafter what is happening and how you view these transformative or derivative works which come from there. So it's difficult to give you like a straight answer just on the basis of the question that you've asked, but yeah, you're right. There are different players involved. There are different bits that we'll have to look at and what fundamentally flows from, say, an end user license agreement. Vijayant, would you maybe like to take the question on the avatars and personality rights in that bit?
Sure. So in terms of, so publicity rights will only apply to a person's, to a individual's personality, meaning their name, image or likeness. Now, if the question is about publicity rights that apply over the avatars, I don't think you could have a publicity right over an avatar. But if you are saying, if the question is rather that if you create an avatar or which is similar or which presents the likeness of a celebrity or a player, then yes, there is a claim to be made over there. And the question of liability then definitely does arise. So there is a claim to be made, but that will be made by the person whose likeness is being replicated by the avatar in that game. But the question on liability, whose liability it is, that's still a bit muddled. There's no clear guidance on that.
Vijayant, if I could add, I think we're not very far from that day when the in-game avatars that we create, being an extension of our personality, may become something we can claim rights in. I mean, that day could be in here already, or it could be something on the horizon. So I do think there is, of course, I agree with what you said, but there is that, I don't rule out that possibility of our in-game avatars being an extension of our personality, being something we could maybe someday a court rules that, you know, you have personality rights in that as well. So
absolutely, agreed.
Yeah. What would you like us to answer next, Neha? I'm trying to just... go through.
I'm going to pause you there, and I'm going to hand over now to Sarthak and Rishabh, because I have one eye on the clock. But please keep sending in your questions, and we will be taking some more questions at the all the sessions as well. But maybe if we could pause now, and we'll move on to issues on contracts. Maybe some of the questions that are coming up on the chat may be answered in that session as well. So over to Vishak and Sarthak now. Okay, Aman, while we wait for Sarthak to sort out technical difficulties, do you want to take up Yash's question? If there's a live stream of an all-ball match that's happening, can I show that match on my Twitch channel?
If there's usually,
the full question is, usually the live stream is taken down. And how is it different from watching an esports tournament and sharing live commentary with live viewers, which is usually interestingly not taken down? So how are we differentiating between a live stream and this live commentary?
I'm not sure I exactly get the question. So are you saying in a volleyball match which is being cast, you live stream that on Twitch?
That's the way I'm understanding your question.
Okay. Because there would be an element, I mean, so that telecast of the match itself is, there are broadcast reproduction rights which apply to that. So that is an act of infringement in itself. So even if there's an esports tournament which is being, is the question live commentary or live streaming that? Is my...
There are two parts to it. So the question, Yash's question is about live streaming the football match on the Twitch channel. And you see that live stream is taken down. But in contrast, he says, if I'm hosting an esports tournament and I'm sharing a live commentary with viewers, that's usually not a game developer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that was what Vijayan's argument was as well, is when you are doing live commentary so let's assume that the stream itself is like a licensed stream, or the person who's hosting the tournament does not mind other people streaming that. Let's keep that aside for now. But the aspect of live commentary on something is in fact a new work in itself. Interestingly, I mean, these questions did come up when we were talking about even live reporting of scores, whether, you know, there is some rights that publishers have in that. And there was questions around the hot news doctrine, whether you can report live scores. But I would say that if you're giving commentary alongside something, commentary should work in itself, and it shouldn't be really be a problem. I'm not sure if I've gotten the question. I can't really see my screen right now. So I'm sorry if maybe we can continue this question offline or later.
Oh, certainly. Sarthak, are you back with us, or should we do a few more questions with Sarthak?
Can you hear me, guys?
I can, but there's a lot of echo, Sarthak.
Okay, just let me try.
If you're using two devices, turn one off.
Okay, Aman, time for one more question.
Sure.
Anya wants to know if players can also use the first sale doctrine. Can I say that I've already purchased a copy or I've subscribed to play the game? Basically, any addition that I make then will become mine to commercialize.
Great question. Again, it's a question of what amounts to sale. Because like typically when a game is sold to you, you are only given a limited license, which is governed by the end user license agreement. So the first sale doctrine, while it's easier to apply and say if you bought a physical copy of a book, or you literally bought the book, but in a software, you get a license rather than actual any ownership. You typically get ownership in the physical media that you bought. So if you bought a CD, you have ownership on that, and then you can argue first use to maybe share it with your friends and pass it on further. But if the end user license agreement stops you from creating derivative works, then I guess you're kind of stuck with that, and which is what gives a lot of power to the game publishers over how tournaments are conducted, whether streaming is allowed or not. I mean, they typically let you stream because it's a, like Jin said, it's a source of revenue and a promotional activity for them as well. Does that answer your question, Tanya? I hope it does.
I hope it does as well. Sarthak, are you with us? Okay. I don't know. I think Sarthak is still sorting out technical difficulties. Raja, could we move on to you and maybe talk about some of the issues in taxation?
Sure, Nia.
And then we'll come back to Sarthak. All right, perfect. Thank you. Over to you.
I'm going to start
the presentation?
Sure, just give me a second. I'm going to be presentation as well. So while I do that, maybe Rajat, you could give us a quick introduction, and I'll just pull up your presentation screen.
Hi, everyone. So I'm going to be talking about the certain indirect tax as well as direct tax issues being faced by the digital games and sports. As we all know, they are broadly categorized into two categories. One is the indirect taxes, and the second is the direct taxes. While indirect taxes are governed by the provisions of the Goods and Service Tax Law, direct taxes are governed by the provisions of the Income Tax Act. Now, before I go into the specifics of taxation aspects governing online gaming in India, it is important to keep in mind three fundamental tenets of any taxation system worldwide. A taxation system needs to be certain, it has to be consistent, and third, it has to be tax neutral. Any taxation system that lacks certainty, consistency, and neutrality cannot be called economically efficient. Now, moving on to the indirect tax aspects specifically, typically speaking, GST is a tax on supply of goods or services for a consideration. Therefore, for a levy of GST, there are three important ingredients that are required to be present. There has to be a supply. What is being supplied should be either goods or services, and that supply should be in lieu of a consideration. If these three ingredients are not supplied, that transaction will not have GST implications. Now, let us extrapolate this on a typical business model for any online fantasy league or other digital gaming platforms. First issue is Kartha, can you move to the third slide? Next slide. So the first step is obviously when a customer's contribute an entry amount which is held by an independent trustee or custodian as a pool. Now, do GST implications arise on this? No, no GST implications arise as this is merely a transaction in money. We need to keep in mind that there are three fundamental tenets of a levy of GST. There has to be goods and services. Money is kept outside the definition of goods. Therefore, there is no goods. Secondly, there is no consideration because the amount is just being kept in a pool. Consideration presupposes quid pro quo. The amount is just kept in a pool without any obligation. Therefore, merely a transaction in money, and GST implications will not arise. The step two is out of this amount which is contributed as a pool, operator is being paid the platform fee. Do GST implications arise? Yes, because the platform operator gets the fees for providing the platform. So there is an element of service which is being there. Therefore, the GST implications will arise. And third, winning prizes are transferred to the wallet of the winner. Again, no GST implications will arise because it is also mainly transaction in money where the winning prize is just transferred to the winner without any underlining supply of goods or services. So winner doesn't supply any goods or services but gets to win the game. Therefore, GST implications will not arise as it is mainly a transaction in money. Now, the question arises, if only the one transaction is applicable to GST, which is when the operator is being paid the platform fee, what will be the rate of GST? As you can see on the slide, there are three competing entries. First entry is GST applicable on betting and gambling services at the rate of 28%. Second entry is GST applicable at the rate of 28% on sports and recreational services. And third is the residuary entry, which is the other online content, which is again chargeable to, which is chargeable to 18%. Now, in my opinion, the services provided by the online digital gaming platforms or the games of skills are not covered under the ambit of betting and gambling because we've seen there is enough jurisprudence in India which distinguishes between games of chances, betting and gambling, and the games of skills. Therefore, the first entry does not cover. Second, sports and recreational sports services, if you see the scheme of the GST, it covers only the physical sports. Therefore, it won't get covered here also. Therefore, we are covered under the third category, which is the residuary category, and which is chargeable at 18%, which is the service rates applicable to other online content. Now, however, what the tax authorities do, they often equate the services of a skill gaming operator with those of betting and gambling. Now, this results in twofold problems. One is GST, instead of being charged at 18%, is now demanded at 28%. Secondly, the valuation mechanism, as is provided for a totalizator in GST, is now made applicable to the online gaming platforms, and GST is demanded on the total participation amount, that is the both the pool and the fee, and at the rate of maximum rate of 28%. Now, this results in a completely economically inefficient taxation system because if the GST is charged at 28% on the entire stake amount, the rate of taxation goes to 140% of the total platform fee, which is completely economically unviable for the platform. And this is completely wrong also because, as we say, the GST is a levy on supply of goods or services. Supply in turn is a transfer or an exchange for a consideration, which presupposes a quid pro quo. Therefore, the amount contributed by the customer is not for the provision of service. It is just kept in the pool for ultimate distribution to the winner. It is not a consideration for any underlining supply. Therefore, GST, question of GST does not arise. Sadha, can you move to the next slide? Therefore, in case of transactions in money, there is no GST implication. Therefore, in case of skill-based online games, amounts susceptible to GST should be limited only to the platform fee. This view is also echoed by the recent High Court High Court of Bombay judgment in the case of Gurdeep Singh Sarchar versus Union of India, where it has been held that online gambling services are excluded from the category, online gaming services are excluded from the category of betting and gambling. The case also affirms that online gaming services to be based on skill, and holds that the services of the platform fall under the residuary category of other online content, not under the category of gambling and betting. However, since the judgment of the High Court of Bombay has now been stayed by the Supreme Court, there is a lot of confusion as to what do the industry do. In such a case, you have the industry can go about discharging GST at the rate of 28% on the entire stake pool amount, but that will be an economically very inefficient and make you very, very incompetitive in the market, because the amount of taxation would be 140% of the platform fee. Or second option is you pay continue to pay GST at the rate of 18% only on the platform fee. Now, this is a risky position, because if you adopt this position, you run the risk of inviting a show cause notice, not right now, but say 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the line, wherein the department will demand not only the differential amount of tax, but also interest for 5 years at the rate of 18%, as also equivalent amount of penalty, which will be a very, very grave situation. Now, in a situation, what is the way forward for an assessee or a taxpayer? In my opinion, I think all the taxpayers should either file an intervention in the Supreme Court in the case which is being there and get the hearing expedited. Second option which is available is under the GST Act, which is to go for an advance ruling. In advance, the advantage of an advance ruling mechanism is that the results are out within a period of 90 days and the judgment is binding on both the taxpayer as well as the authorities. Now, even if the judgment is against you, you have the option of going into an appeal or agitate in a writ petition before the High Court or Supreme Court, in which case you don't have to wait for 5 years for department to issue a show cause notice. You will get certainty in, say, year's time. Therefore, these are the two way forwards. I'll briefly touch upon direct tax aspects. Compared to indirect taxes, there aren't too many issues under direct taxes. However, there are a couple of aspects that I'd like to talk about. Can you move to the direct tax slides? First is the definition of income under the Income Tax Act covers any winnings from lotteries, crosswords, puzzles, races, including horse races, card games, and other games of any sort, from the definition of or from gambling or betting of any form or nature whatsoever in the definition of income. The Supreme Court has interpreted this to cover wide enough to cover winnings from even skill-based game. Therefore, there is a parity under the income tax between the games of skills and the games of betting and gambling, which in my opinion is wrong. The rate of taxation which is applied is 31.2%, including all the surcharges, on the aggregate amount of the winning. If your winning is greater than 10,000 rupees, the gaming company deducts TDS at the rate specified under section 194B of the Income Tax Act. And as per section 58, you don't get any deductions. Now, there are two sets of problems in my opinion. The one is a similar tax treatment for skill and chance-based game is wrong, especially given the fact that there is enough jurisprudence in India on the difference between the games of skill and games of chance. Second is the deductions and set-offs should be permitted for income earned from digital skill-based games. Winners should be allowed to set off the winning in one game against the losses in the other. And there is no reason why a platform fee should not be allowed as a deduction before winnings are taxed. So that is it about direct taxes. I'll briefly discuss about the equalization levy, which is recently introduced in the Finance Act 2020 and is applicable only to the foreign gaming platform. With effect from April 1, 2020, the Finance Act 2020 has enlarged the scope of equalization levy to levy a equalization levy of 2% on the amount of consideration received or receivable by an e-commerce operator for an e-commerce supply or services made or provided or facilitated by it. Now, the definition of e-commerce supply and e-commerce operator are very wide, and in my opinion will also include the online gaming platforms, which for an online gaming platform. And at this point of time, there is lack of clarity as to whether equalization levy will apply on the total pooled amount or only on the platform fee. In my opinion, it should be levied only on the platform fee. So that is it. I'll take some questions on direct tax and indirect taxes if you do have any.
Thanks so much. There's one question that's coming. If deposit into the wallet of the customer is non-refundable, then would GST be applicable on the entire deposit money as it is non-refundable and thereby akin to revenue for the platform?
It's a very good question. If the amount is non-refundable, it depends on the terms of the contract. If the amount is non-refundable, it will be in the nature, it can be in the nature of a penalty, which is which might get covered under one of the entries which says tolerance of an act or agreeing to do an act, which is very widely interpreted by the departmental authorities to cover all sorts of income under the ambit of GST. These are basically any sort of passive income gets covered. So there is a likelihood that a non-refundable deposit can be made taxable. However, there have been certain case laws where it has been held under the context of service tax law, which is the predecessor law, where the non-refundable security deposit in case of rent leases has been held to be non-taxable. So there is a case made to be made out that non-refundable deposits are not taxable because they are not in the nature of income, they are in nature of penalty, and penalty per se you cannot make tax. Be made liable to tax. However, the scope of GST has been expanded because of this particular entry that I just spoke about. Therefore, it's a debatable position. It's to be made out that it will not be taxable. I'll take up the second question, which is, how is the money earned through YouTube videos containing gaming taxed? So money earned through YouTube videos containing gaming content will be taxed like any other income. It'll be part of your, if you do it on a regular basis, and if there is a certain degree of continuity, it will be taxed as a business and professional income as per the slabs applicable to you. Any other questions?
I had one actually. Okay, there's one more. In the event a gamer purchases a gaming, In the event a gamer purchases a game online via PS Store or Xbox, or the Xbox Store, would GST be levied? And there's one from Gayatri after that.
Very good question. There is a specific entry under the GST, which is called the OIDAR, Online Information and Distribution Services, which takes all the services on the cloud and on the cloud, including the online gaming also within the ambit of GST. So therefore, GST would be applicable. That will depend on where the service provider's server is located. If you are downloading it from a foreign server, there may be a even the place of provision of service is the place where the recipient is located, but you'll have to see the place of provision of service rules in this regard as to who is the service provider, from where are you downloading. Next question is, how are in-app purchases taxed both under GST and direct tax for the game publisher? In-app purchases under GST again will depend where the from where it is being supplied. Any game supplied through an app will be exigible to GST because there is a definite element of supply. The income which is earned by the app would be subject to direct taxes after taking into account all the deductions for expenses. Any more questions?
Perfect. Rajat, I'm going to exercise moderator privileges here. There's one follow-up, I think. So does it depend on the residency status of the game publisher? I think that's a follow-up to the point that you were just making.
Absolutely. See, the in GST, the tax is payable if the place of provision of services in India. Now, there are specific rules under the Integrated Service Tax Act as to how do we determine where the place of provision of services, and depend on case to case basis. So if the service provider is outside India and the service recipient is inside India, in that case, the place where the services will be determined as per the place of provision of service rules. And if the place of provision of service rules is in, as per the place of provision of service rules, the place of provision of service is in India, then will be taxable under GST under the reverse charge mechanism.
Perfect. All right. Thank you very much, Rajat. I have a couple of questions for you myself, but I'm going to save them for right at the very end. Can we move on to Sarthak and Vishak? I think we have Sarthak back with us now.
Can you hear me?
Contracts. Yes.
Thank God. So Hi guys, so sorry that you cannot see me, but I'll still try to make this as interactive as possible. So very quickly, I am Sarthak Doshi. I have my friend Vishak Ranjit with me, and we will be talking about esports and contractual issues that are esports. So we will have our discussion in two parts. The part one will be on the esport governance model that internationally and in India, which I'll be dealing with. And the second part will be on player contracts, which Vishak will be dealing with. We'll be covering two types of contracts. One is contracts with teams or clans, or another contract with the national teams where you're representing your country. So very quickly, for our audience who may confuse esports with other digital games, I would just say esports is those kind of digital games that replicate the same values and skills that you need in a typical sport. If you just see the screen, there are all of these things that make up an esport. All the skill, the diet, the participation of team events, even the prize money that you have in competition. So esport is very much a sport, arguably even more skillful than a traditional sport. If you can just move to the next slide. So there are a number of stakeholders that are involved in esports. You have various teams, you have publishers who make different kind of games. So, this is a good point to say that esport is not a single sport. There are a number of sports that make up an esport. So you have Call of Duty, you have Dota, you have StarCraft, you have League of Legends, a number of esport games which collectively make esports. So as I was saying, there are different stakeholders in esports. You have teams, you have game publishers who have control over that game. There are a number of international tournaments and leagues, you know, World Cup, League of Legends, World Dota Championship, things like that. And on the other hand, there are a number of fans who spectate esports on their mobile devices or on live stream. And then there are a number of brands who sponsor these esports events. So all in all, there are a number of stakeholders that are relevant in esports. Having so many stakeholders creates a very unique esports governance structure globally for esports. So it is not something that you would typically see in a traditional sport. So for those of you who follow cricket and football, there is a pyramid structure to each sport. For example, in cricket, you have the International Cricket Council at the global level. Then you have the BCCI in India. Then there is coordination between national, state, local, and district associations that ensures a proper governance. And this also ensures that you have trials right from the grassroots level that are represented by the country and then go to the global level. So proper structure in place where we have in a traditional sport. Because of all the stakeholders I spoke about in esport, this governance model is not something we see here. We do have a international body, but there is not one international body. There are three in esports. You have the International Esports Federation, you have the Global Esports Federation, and you also have the World Esports Federation. So as opposed to one, you have three bodies at the top level. And another thing that is different here is the main body is not exercising all the controls. The game publisher who owns individual games has the majority of control. Now, this is also something I'll draw from what Aman and Vijayan were speaking about, that game publishers have a lot of right and concentration of power. So all the leagues, tournaments, you know, all of these things that would typically be done by an association, here they are done by each of those game publishers. Some of them, they have their own leagues. Some of them have contracts with esports organizers and they do it like that. So they decide the rules of the game. Now, this governance structure, esports does not necessarily need to replicate the structure that we have in traditional sports, but there are definitely some learnings we can include in esports so that we create two fundamental issues that esports is grappling with from a lot of time. The first one would be of legitimacy. Aman, if you can just move to the next slide. The first principal issue becomes of legitimacy. You would have heard, so a number of stakeholders in esports are trying to push for esports to be competitive at a, you know, more global or international platform. We do have esports World Cups for different games currently, but still esports is not there at the Olympics. So having a proper governance structure would give esports a shot to be played at the Olympics. One of the principal things which the Olympic Council, the International Olympic Association, also said that there is no single representation from this community, which is, you know, kind of a roadblock for us to include esports in the main event. So that is one thing that can happen by having a proper governance structure. Other things that can flow from it is to have a proper visa structure, esports players getting visas to be in other countries, something which US has done beautifully, which we can also adopt. Another thing would be to receive eligibility in terms of scholarship, so that esports players right at the from the school and the college level are motivated to become and participate in esports. Other things like having a professional tag and be included under the entire labor and employment law regime that we have under the country will also ensure some protection to these esports players. And the last benefit that can come out of it is would be of more funding and infrastructural support. So if you would know, esports requires a lot of heavy equipment, devices, headphones, you know, special gear, AR glasses and things like that, which a normal sports person won't be able to afford. So if there is a proper governance structure like we spoke about, it will ensure that there is, you know, regular grant in terms of funding and all infrastructural support that will benefit the player. So this is one benefit that can come out from having a proper governance structure. Other benefit would be of regulations, which I would like Vishak to take over from him.
Thank you, Sarthak. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Sarthak, for that introduction and talking about the foundational aspects of governance. Like Sarthak said, there are two specific benefits that can come out of having a proper governance model. One is legitimacy, like you discussed, and the second is uniform regulation. What does regulation give us? Regulation gives us two important things. It ensures the integrity of competitions, and also it ensures contractual stability. When you talk about integrity, we're talking about issues like match fixing, doping, conflicts of interest, corruption, fraud. Any issue that deals with the competitive integrity of the sport itself. So you need proper, well-developed codes in place to prevent all this. An interesting model that exists right now and was formed recently is the Esports Integrity Commission, formerly called Esports Integrity Coalition. They have actually set up a model where they have members who can sign up to the codes that they have developed, and their codes cover all these issues. So it might be interesting for people to know that an Indian Counter-Strike player was actually banned by the ESIC when he was found cheating in 2018. So, and that was a 5-year ban. So there are strict punishments. These things are dealt with seriously. So ESIC is a good model to look at as to how we can ensure integrity. Second issue is contractual stability. It's a term that's used in traditional sports commonly to talk about issues that involve balancing of freedom of movement of players and also the interests of teams to keep their valuable assets, that is the players. So concepts like transfer windows, how termination can happen of contracts with players, buyout clauses, restrictions on poaching of players and players negotiating with other teams, these are all in pursuance of contractual stability. Can I have the next slide, please? So why are contracts relevant and why should we talk about it in esports? As we said, there is no uniform regulatory system in place right now. So because of this, all the legal relationships in the industry are currently governed by these contracts. In the previous sections, already we spoke about licensing and intellectual property issues. Now, area where you require more regulatory intervention, governance intervention, is player contracts, because there you're dealing with protection of rights of individuals and teams. So some of the speakers before explained, publishers exert a lot of control. Some of them run their own competitions. So such publishers usually get involved in regulations. As an example, you can look at Riot Games. They are the publisher of League of Legends, which is a very popular game, arguably the most popular game. So they have their own continental leagues and a world championship. All of these have very specific regulations. They have team participation agreements, which the teams are supposed to sign, which include minimum standards for contracts. So there they have bans on non-compete clauses. They have a maximum length that the player contract can have. So these very specific issues are addressed by these regulations. But this is an exception. This is not the norm in the industry. So usually the publishers would rather take a hands-off approach and license the game to an organizer who would then organize the league or competition on the basis of his own rules. So, which is why we need to look at what are the issues. What are the issues right now with respect to contracts in the industry? One, it's very common that there are no written contracts. Even though the market is so well developed now, even in the US and in Europe, you see that often there are players who are with teams on the basis of overall. Or even if there are contracts, you see contracts which are one-page contracts, which don't really talk about all the rights and obligations. Also, what we have to think about is the age of the players. Players often get into esports when they're really young. They don't really necessarily have the guidance that they are entering into. They're often minors who don't have the capacity to contract. So these are all very specific issues related to esports contracts in the industry. Now, as Sathak mentioned before, we'll be dealing with two specific types of contracts. First is contracts players have with teams or clans. And next, about national team contracts. So firstly, about team or clan contracts. Now, I will not be going in very into too much depth on each of these clauses, but I would like to touch upon the major issues. So first of all, the contract has very clearly laid down what the services are of the player to the team. Is it only playing competitions? Is it only playing very specific games? Is it only playing very specific tournaments? Or is it general? Is the player supposed to also stream gaming content while he's not playing tournaments? How many hours of such streaming should he do in a month? All of these very specific issues as to what the services of a player are should be very clearly outlined in the agreement. Whether it's exclusive, whether he can represent other teams in other games. All of these things, very important. Even with respect to streaming, is the player allowed to have a personal stream? Or all his streaming should go through the team channel? These are issues that need to be considered and very clearly laid down in the contracts. Second issue is image rights. As was discussed earlier, unlike traditional sports, in esports, it's not just the physical image of the player that's important, it's also the in-game avatar. It's the gamer tag of the player. These things take the form of intellectual property of the player. So how it is licensed to the team, and what is the extent of the utilization that the team can do? Whether the team can continue using his image after he has left the team. All of these issues, again, need to be very clearly laid down. Some high-profile players could even negotiate extra compensation for the use of their image separately. Third very important issue is training and benching. Training, as was mentioned earlier, players are often required to train more upwards of 10 hours a day. And this means that you should consider the effect of such activity on the player. Continuous usage of the screen has been shown to cause some problems in players. So again, all of these issues need to be considered while putting in the clause of how many hours of training are required from them. Benching is an important issue to be very specifically laid down in the contract, because in the industry, what happens is that there is a starting lineup of players who commonly play the tournaments. Then there are substitutes, then there are reserves. So depending on where the player stands in this hierarchy, his remuneration is usually affected. So that needs to be very clearly laid down in the contract. There was a recent case of Owen Butterfield, a Counter-Strike player, who had came out with the news that his salary was reduced from $2,000 to $700 a month when he was benched. So you can see that there's a big impact on such activity. So how a player is benched, when can he be benched, how long can he be benched, what is the effect on remuneration, all of these things need to be very clearly laid down in the contract. Termination, how a contract would be terminated. Is there a buyout clause? Is there a right of first refusal for the team in case the player wants to leave? What are the restrictions on talking to other teams while under contract? All of these things, again, need to be very clearly laid down because of the lack of regulation. Revenue sharing is important because in esports, as opposed to traditional sports, players often receive a percentage of the revenue that the team makes. So if it's merchandising or money from in-game, selling in-game items or sponsorship or prize money, all of these, often you see that players receive a percentage. So how much of this percentage? When will the player be paid? How will the player be paid? All of these things need to be, again, very specifically laid down. there was a recent case of involving FaZe Clan, where a player sued them very publicly, and was a very controversial issue in the US, where a player claimed that the team has taken too much of the percentage of sponsorship revenue, and he claimed that the contract was unfair. And that's created a lot of controversy in the industry. So you can see that already these issues are being taken to court. So when teams and players enter into such contracts, these things need to be very carefully considered. Dispute resolution, there should be a preference for arbitration, in my opinion, because the players' careers are very short, and we cannot wait for the litigation to move. So if there are intense delays in litigation, then you shouldn't move towards the litigation, and you should try and opt for arbitration. That is with respect to, that's what I want to say with respect to this issue. But we do have an article that I've written in collaboration with Ikigai on the Ikigai website if you want to read more about this issue. Moving on to the next type of contracts, national team contracts. So I'll quickly touch upon the issues. One, the difference here is that the player will only be contracted on a per tournament basis. So if there's an Asian Games, and there'll be a contract specific to that tournament, that is the most ideal model for such international competitions. So again, a very interesting issue where you can compare to traditional sports is that will it be mandatory for them to release the players for national competitions? In traditional sports, in football, you can see that FIFA rules mandate that players have to be released by clubs for international competitions. So there is no such regulatory mechanism in esports. So how do we handle that issue? Costs. How are costs covered when player is traveling internationally for such competitions? Is it the Indian Federation that's handling it? Is it the international federation that will cover the costs? All of these issues have to be clearly laid down. Image rights can also have a conflict with the clan, because the clan holds certain rights to the player's image. Can the player's image be then utilized by the national team? Can only the player in a national jersey or in a specific national team context be an image such as that can be utilized by the national teams? That's something to consider. And generally, there is a lot of uncertainty in India. As mentioned before, there is no proper regulatory structure. Even though we did win a bronze medal, as you can see on the screen, in Hearthstone in the Asian Games, there is still a lot of things that can be done towards bringing certainty in the industry. And that will, of course, ensure better growth and ensure that contracts are not so haphazard, and there's more uniformity, and that helps, and that creates ease of business for both teams and players and other stakeholders. So that's all from me. If anyone has any questions, I can take them. And if Sarthak wants to add something, please do. Otherwise, Neha, please.
Thank you so very much, Vishak and Sarthak. We have lots and lots of questions that have come in for you. We've shared the two articles that Vishak had spoken about on esports contracts and governance for esports on this chat. So feel free to have a look. Aman, we'll start with Aman's last question. Is there a way around click-clack contracts which we seemingly have to accept in case we want to play such games? And there's another one related to contracts. Can blockchain technology be used for simplifying contractual ambiguity by providing smart contracts, which will also ensure transparency in such contracts? So either one of you.
Okay. With respect to click-clack contracts, the issue, that issue usually comes up in terms of social gaming, casual gaming, in my understanding. So when you talk about esports, competitive esports at least, and you talk about player team contracts, then there is much more actual negotiation and work put into ensuring a proper contract. In terms of casual gaming contracts, depends on how rights you would want to exercise flowing from that. So if you're playing competitively, if you're representing the country, etc., then of course we need a regulatory mechanism to ensure that there is no such automatic acceptance of terms by players. In terms of blockchain technology, of course, any new forms of technology can be used to improve our legal situation right now. But what we actually need is more regulation. We need guidelines and sort of something, an overarching structure in place to ensure that there are minimum standards in these contracts. Transparency, of course, will help and will create more awareness and for players, young players who are getting into the industry. But without an umbrella regulation which covers all of these issues, I think the issues that exist today will still continue to remain.
Thanks so much. Can we do one last question before we move on to the next session, and we'll come back to any remaining questions at the end? There's one, since the last point made, Vishak, was incidentally about the fact that there should be a lot more regulation. Yash has a question. Shouldn't regulation also be there to decrease the power of game developers? And he's giving you an example there, and he wants to know if we should, if there needs to be a different appellate body as well.
Sathak, do you want to take that?
Sure. So, yeah, like, of course, a better appellate body would help. Currently, I think the example you are quoting, Yash, is of one game developer blocking people from their game and not allowing them access to that game, which is always the problem, like we spoke about, with concentration of power with game developers. If the person who owns the game sets the rules of the game, then it creates issues, and it also leads to lack of uniformity from one game to another. So yes, like an independent body that has the same standards on blocking players and making them eligible or not eligible, because things like cheating and e-doping are quite prevalent in esports. So it would really help if we have a separate appellate body where every player is heard at the same stage.
Just to add to that, as of now, the Court of Arbitration deals with a lot of forms this appellate role in traditional sports. It is something that can be looked at by industry players to involve the CAS in dispute resolution in esports. As of now, they have not dealt with a single esports case. But going forward, it could possibly be a mechanism that could help. And anyway, the Esports Integrity Commission has a dispute resolution mechanism that they use to enforce bans. So already there are some mechanisms in place for this. But of course, an appellate body which is independent will be necessary so that the influence of stakeholders does not translate such restrictions.
All right, perfect. Thank you so very much, Sarsak, for that very insightful presentation. I'm now handing this over to Arpit and to Aprajita to digital payments.
All right. Thank you so much, Neha. So thank you so much, everyone, for coming for our webinar today. We've been through three topics. We've spoken about IPR, tax, and contractual issues. And now we'll be starting with digital payments and digital games. Now, Aprajita and I will be following a slightly different format. So we are doing this in a Q&A format where I'll be asking Aprajita some questions. And she'll be explaining through those questions as to how digital payments work in digital gaming platforms. Now, so Aprajita, why don't we start with first discussing that, which kind of payment instrument do you feel is the most suitable for digital gaming platforms?
So hi everyone. Arpit, there are multiple instruments that one can use for a digital gaming platform. And you can use a credit card, a debit card, and a regular payment gateway will allow you a bouquet of payment services. You could use, like I said, credit card, debit card, net banking, UPI. But I want to use this time to talk about one payment instrument which I believe is the most suitable payment instrument for a digital game, and that's an e-wallet. An e-wallet is similar to a store of money, which you can easily use at any point in time to... Sorry, is the video buffering? Are you guys able to see me?
Yes, we can see you.
Okay. So an e-wallet is a quick store of money, which you can at any point in time dip into and make a quick spend from. So it's akin to a physical wallet in that you give up the ability to earn interest on your funds for the convenience of being able to dip into those funds at any point in time to be able to make a quick spend. So specifically in a digital app, or a digital game scenario, you want to be able to make a quick purchase. upgrade to buy a new in-app feature, the ability to place a bet within a card game. You want to be able to make these spends without the friction of entering an OTP, entering a password, going through any kind of authentication process. And that's why e-wallets serve as a really good medium of paying for digital games.
Sure. So that's interesting that you draw the analogy between an e-wallet and a physical wallet. But could you also talk about what are the different kinds of wallets that are there, specifically under the legal framework that governs digital wallets in India?
Sure. So there are three kinds of e-wallets. There's a closed wallet, a semi-closed wallet, and an open wallet. For the purposes of a digital game, the two that are important is a closed wallet and a semi-closed wallet. A closed wallet is a very, very simple instrument. It has one use case and one only, and that's the issuer can allow you to make spends with the goods and services that the issuer provides. So to put it simply, if Arpit, if Marks and Spencer issued you a Marks and Spencer closed wallet, you could only load funds on that closed wallet to buy goods from Marks and Spencer's. You couldn't buy a third party good or service from the funds lying in your closed wallet. While a semi-closed wallet allows that functionality. So for instance, if you have a Paytm wallet, which is a semi-closed wallet, you can make spends with anyone Paytm has an agreement with. So if it could be Ferns and Petals, it could be Amazon, any merchant with which Paytm already has an agreement, you can make a spend with that merchant. Semi-closed wallet also has a functionality of allowing peer-to-peer payments. So if I wanted to send you money from my Paytm account to Arpit's Paytm account, I could do that using my semi-closed wallet. A closed wallet does not allow that functionality. It has, like I said, it has a single use case. You can load it, spend it with the issuer, and that's it. And the issuer must be the entity which provides you the good or service for which you can make that spend. So in a digital game scenario, if I want to make purchases only from the platform which is hosting the digital game, a closed wallet works fine. If I don't want to allow my users to make peer-to-peer payments, a closed wallet is perfect. The downside of a semi-closed wallet is that it requires a license from the RBI, which is not an easy license to acquire. It also requires the users to conduct KYC, a full KYC, in a manner similar to what is required to open a bank account, to be able to switch on the functionality of peer-to-peer transfers. If you don't conduct KYC on a semi-closed wallet, you can't even spend more than 10,000. Your limit gets staggered to 10,000. If you do KYC, your limit gets uncapped to 1 lakh. So a closed wallet is good for a digital gaming platform that wants to offer its users the quick ability to spend within the game. But if you want to switch on additional features like peer-to-peer payments, like the ability of a digital gaming platform to act as a marketplace for third-party gaming products, then it makes sense for the digital gaming platform to do one of two things. Either the platform goes and acquires a license on its own, or alternatively, it integrates with an entity which already has that license. So for instance, it integrates a Paytm within its own platform.
Right. So it's interesting that you've discussed these use cases of a P2P transfer. Like I can imagine, for example, if someone wanted to, let's say an advanced player wanted to tutor a less advanced player on the platform, you could accept money through P2P transfer. I can imagine in-game purchases being traded through a P2P transfer on that gaming platform itself. But at the same time, you also mentioned how an additional compliance burden comes in if you are opting for a semi-closed wallet, because you need to be KYC compliant and you need the RBI's authorization as well. So how does this trade-off work? Do you think it's worth it for gaming companies to go ahead and get a semi-closed wallet only to be able to explore the use cases with respect to P2P transfer between different players?
Yeah. A closed wallet actually works very well for a digital gaming platform. It serves as a quick store of funds. I want to quickly pay 10 rupees for an in-app purchase. I want to up my bidding in a rummy game. I can do that very easily with a closed wallet. With a semi-closed wallet, specifically with the functionality of peer-to-peer payments, you're absolutely correct. It switches on many use cases. the moment you have peer-to-peer payments attached to social interaction, it increases the engagement amongst users. So for instance, Arpit played a really good move in a particular digital game, and I wanted to send an appreciation to him. Instead of just sending him a smiley face or a like, I can actually send him a quick peer-to-peer transfer of funds to his wallet. So if a gaming platform intends peer-to-peer payments to be one of its core use cases around which it builds many different product features, then yes, a semi-closed wallet does make sense. And primarily if the digital gaming platform wants to act as a marketplace, it doesn't just want to sell you its own products, it wants to sell you third-party products, then for sure a semi-closed wallet does make sense. But at the same time, one must remember that to open a semi-closed wallet for a user has some onboarding friction. Even for a min KYC wallet, which is up to the amount of 10,000, a user will need to put in name and OTP verification and a unique number given in one of her identity documents. So a driving license unique number, an election card unique number. With that 10,000 rupees semi-closed wallet, she can't make peer-to-peer payments. She can only make spends. So it only makes sense for her to take that wallet if she wants to buy any third-party products within the digital gaming platform's ecosystem.
Sure.
She'll have to upgrade to a full KYC wallet, which means she has to do the same kind of KYC that it would need to open a bank account to be able to make peer-to-peer payments between friends. And these are small, on-the-fly transactions. It's 10 rupees within the use case of P2P transfers. And just for the functionality that she doesn't want to make these transfers through another payment instrument to open a semi-closed wallet with a full KYC, it doesn't seem worth it in the gaming app scenario. If the gaming platform simply wants to switch on peer-to-peer payments, it can do so through other modes. It can do a UPI integration. It does have the friction of entering a UPI PIN each time you want to make a peer-to-peer payment. But on the flip side, it does allow these transfers to happen seamlessly and directly from one bank account to the other. The advantage also to a gaming platform by integrating a closed wallet is that it's a captive audience. The moment I loaded my closed wallet within a digital game, I can only and only use those funds on the digital gaming platform itself. So funds can't leak out of the digital gaming platform. Once I've made the spend to load the wallet, I have only one use case. I'm locked in to spend only on that platform. So from a digital gaming platform's perspective, it's a very attractive payment option to offer closed wallets because you can lock the user in. And the user can then quickly make spends through her life cycle in interacting with the gaming platform.
Right. It's interesting that you mentioned about the exclusivity that gaming companies can gain through closed wallets. Just quickly, do you think that even after using a closed wallet, there could be certain benefits of a gaming company conducting the KYC process voluntarily? And in that case, what stages in the payment transaction do you think should the company or the platform conduct the KYC process?
So KYC, as the name suggests, is know your customer. Who is my customer at the other end, and do I trust this customer? So there are three. Closed wallet absolutely does require KYC. It's a regulatorily unfettered product. You can issue a closed wallet and loading it, deducting it is simply a ledger entry at the end of the digital gaming platform. As far as the user is concerned, it's a cash out at the time she loads it, and then she can use it throughout the journey, throughout the life cycle of using the digital app. It doesn't require you to do KYC, but there are three stages at which a gaming company which has integrated a closed wallet on its platform can choose to do KYC. One is at the time that the user downloads the app and onboards himself. This is not the most desirable option because the moment a user has downloaded the app's asked her many questions: what's your identity, how do I do your KYC, go through this XYZ process, and can cause a lot of drop-off at that stage. It's a huge onboarding friction. There's a second stage at which you can do KYC. The user passes through the onboarding stage, doesn't have to do any kind of KYC, is allowed to experience the app, ex- experience the free features of the digital games on the app. And then the moment she says, okay, I want to put real money within the game, I want to load my closed wallet, at that point, the app requires the user to do a KYC voluntarily. A closed wallet does not require you to do KYC, but merely to prevent frauds at this stage, the app says, okay, at this stage, you do your KYC. There's a third stage at which you can ask the user to do KYC, and which, to my mind, is the most important stage if you haven't done it in the first two already. And that's when the user says, I want to withdraw my winnings back to my bank account. I want to make this pull request because I've earned a certain amount. I don't want to deploy it back into the game. I want to pull it back to my bank account. Now, this is the stage where you can see fraud spike. So if your phone is lost, someone logs into your app and makes this pull request back to her bank account, you have lost those winnings, and the app has facilitated a kind of fraud that occurred without having conducted KYC on you. So it's at this stage where the app is the level of fraud at the pull request stage that the app should then ask you to conduct some kind of KYC. Is the user the same user who's playing the game, who's asking for the money to be withdrawn back to her bank account? So these are the three stages. And sure, at the third stage, I think a voluntary KYC of the user is necessary to mitigate fraud.
Sure. All right, Aprajita, I think so this explains to us, one, what are the different options that are available in terms of hosting a digital wallet on a gaming platform, and also the different pros and cons of these two categories of wallets, which we've discussed, being open wallet and, closed wallet and semi-closed wallet. All right, thank you so much. I think we can take questions now on digital payments issues. Also, if anyone has any questions on the previous topics, please feel free to send those in as well. We can address those questions too.
Thank you so much, Arpit and Aprajita. Lots and lots and lots of questions have come in for you as well. I'm just going to pick and choose some. Do all e-wallets offer cross-border payments? That's one. There's some question, and I think Aprajita and Arpit, you did touch upon this a little bit. Won't there be applicability of KYC norms as per the latest RBI guidelines on e-wallets? So maybe if you could share a little bit of insight on what different gaming companies and platforms are doing from the KYC. That could be something that we can talk about as well a little bit.
Sure. There seems to be a bit of an echo.
Sure. Could both of you switch off your microphones? Some of the other questions. Yeah. Okay. There's one more. Concerning India's stand on UPI and the interoperability options available, doesn't that dissuade people from storing money in a wallet? Say a particular game does not recognize one wallet but recognized another e-wallet on which I have not stored money. So UPI interoperability.
So that's a great question on interoperability. And a downside of having a wallet is that you can't transfer money from one wallet issuer to another wallet issuer, till now at least. While theoretically the RBI has allowed it, this hasn't been integrated in practice as yet. And specifically from a closed wallet, you can't even do peer-to-peer transfers. So if Arpit and I are on the same gaming app and he has a closed wallet and I've also opened one, I can't send him money even then. But even with the semi-closed wallet functionality, I can't transfer money from the semi-closed wallet issued to me by issuer A to another semi-closed wallet issued to issuer B right now. There aren't enough issuers who've done that integration, although theoretically it has been unblocked. So the second question that was asked was around KYC. So absolutely. KYC guidelines is something that had put a huge spanner in the work for all digital wallet providers. And gaming companies were also one of the merchants which had, should they want to allow peer-to-peer transfers for their semi-closed wallet users. Now there are multiple ways of doing KYC, but the only ways in which you can do remote KYC are video KYC and OTP-based KYC, which all lead to Aadhaar. So while the KYC guidelines have become applicable to wallets and that has put a spanner in the work for semi-closed wallet, it makes an even stronger case for having a closed loop instrument integrated on your platform, because that doesn't require, not only doesn't require any KYC, it doesn't require any kind of identification. It's simply a store of money that you've kept with the issuer of the wallet or with the digital gaming platform for the purposes of making a quick spend within the gaming experience. Third question was on cross-border transactions. No, all wallets don't allow cross-border transactions. There are very specific conditions for cross-border transactions. Only AD category one banks can allow cross-border transactions. There are fettered limits, monetary limits, which are under the limits for domestic spends that are allowed for cross-border transactions. And it isn't something that you can automatically switch on. There are certain fetters that need to be complied with for cross-border transactions, and it is not something that an issuer, which is a non-bank entity, can issue in the first place. Only AD category bank one can issue it.
Perfect. There are some follow-up questions on integration. I can see one question
by Mayank on integration takes place. How would semi-closed wallets be different from an open wallet? So a semi-closed wallet is fundamentally different from an open wallet in that an open wallet allows cash withdrawal. A semi-closed wallet does not allow cash withdrawal. For the purposes of a digital game, it doesn't really matter, because cash withdrawal is not something that a digital gaming platform is keen to provide its users. The use case for an open wallet is that I can go and withdraw cash at any outlet. It is also only issued by banks. A non-bank entity cannot issue an open wallet. So a PhonePe cannot issue an open wallet. Only an IDFC or an ICICI bank can issue an open wallet. Should you choose to integrate an open wallet, you'll have to do so as a non-banking entity through a co-branding arrangement with the bank which issues the open.
So, Rajita, there are two questions related to virtual coins. Maybe we can quickly touch upon those. Aman has a question where he says, if I buy some in-game coins, points, etc., can I convert those into real money? And Mulkit wants to talk about cryptocurrencies. Where he said many international games have. And what are the compliances required?
Okay, so I'll take Aman's question first. Conversion of points to INR is something that's hazy under the law. So while the moment you say that I will be able to buy a point from the gaming platform and then I'll be able to convert that point back to an INR, you run the risk of operating an unlicensed payment system. The only way that you can be in the regulatory green area is if the digital gaming platform wants to issue you points in the form of an incentive to come on the platform, much like you would issue cashback in the form of INR. If I want to say that I've issued you 10 points as a gift from the platform itself, and then you can then pull this back into INR. That lies in the regulatory green area, but any functionality where I allow my users to purchase points, which I can then convert into INR, is something that can trip a payment system risk, which is not something an unlicensed entity can undertake.
All right, perfect. Thanks so much. Thanks so much for that, Rajita. I am also very conscious of the fact that we seem to be running a little bit over time. I want to quickly go through a couple of the questions that we had received for some of the other sessions. But could we have your closing thoughts on digital, on the world of digital payments and online games and sports.
So it's a very interesting time for digital games. A lot more people are leaning into actually putting money into games, and it's really essential for users to be able to make quick spends within a digital gaming platform. And therefore, we're seeing a lot of PG payment gateway integrations by digital gaming platforms. Digital gaming platforms are no longer just a free to play, and there's a lot of real money consequences within the game itself. And the way to monetize an app is obviously to charge the user at some point in time for some features. And therefore, there's a lot of push for digital payments within the digital gaming world right now. And like I said, one of the best ways to pay digitally within a app, within a gaming app, is through an e-wallet.
Perfect. Thanks so very much, Prajita. Rajat, I will now move to you. There was one question that we had left unaddressed there. Is the GST applicable on the amount of the in-app purchase or the amount after the taxes levied, the equalization levy that you were talking about? The question is, after the Google tax is levied by Google or Apple, and the Google tax is the equalization levy, but it's also the 2016 one, if I understand that correctly. So if you could just clarify for us.
Sure. So in terms of Section 15 of the Central Goods and Service Tax, it says the value of supply shall include any taxes, duties, cesses, fees, and charges leviable under any other law for the time being in force other than this act. So apart from GST, if any tax is levied, they'll be included in the value, going by the strict law of the land. Seems a little unfair, but the value of supply includes any other taxes also.
Perfect. And the same question that I had, there's one more follow-up question that's come. The in-app purchases on loot boxes, will that be taxed according to it being a game of skill or gambling and betting?
So will that be according to being a game of skill or gambling? See, that depends on the nature of the game. If the skill is the predominant part in the nature of the game, and again, this has to be... in the absence of any concrete definition of betting and gambling and what constitutes a skill-based game under the GST Act, that depends on the nature of game, whether it is in-app purchase on the loot boxes or any other game, whether it is a game of skill or whether it is betting and gambling. So it depends completely on the nature of the game.
Okay. And thoughts from you, the same that I posed to Prajita as well. What is the future of digital taxation and digital games and esports look like? Some very, very complicated questions that you presented before us on both direct as well as indirect taxes, GST, the Income Tax Act, the equalization levy, which has now come in, each of them their own complicated animals. So where do we go from here? What do I do as a gaming company, an operator? What's next?
As of now, there are a lot of issues and I would say a lot of gaps between how the taxation system in India operates with respect to not only the gaming platforms but other e-commerce sector also. Like I said, the three fundamental principles of taxation, which is certainty, consistency, and neutrality, at this point of time, the taxation system in India seems to be not adhering to those principles. But having said that, I think advocacy efforts in this regards are already on. More advocacy efforts are needed to make the system, a tax system in place. But, if the advocacy efforts are not resulting in any results, then we are left at the mercy of the courts at this point of time. To judicially determine what is the future of taxation. But that will take some time, 3-4 years, 5 years down the line, before we have final clarity on how the taxes will be applicable on the online gaming sector in India.
Perfect. Thanks so much. Thanks.
Thank you, Neha.
I'm now moving to Vishak and Sarthak. I'm hoping that both of them are still here with us. There's a question that's come in, and this is the one that I also personally find very interesting as a policy lawyer. Has the central or the state government taken any efforts to promote esports in India, which also will lead me to my concluding question, like I've asked Prajita and Rajat. What's next? Where do we sort of go from here? Is there a need to relook at some of the traditional frameworks and the current legal, the current legal frameworks that we have in India? Where do we go from here? On policy, on law?
Sure. So I'll just take that, Vishal. So just to answer the first question, unfortunately, no. Central government has not done much about esports as a category for regulation in India. But on the bright side, we do see different stakeholders making their own initiatives to develop esports in India. So So you would have esport organizers who would have these PUBG tournaments or League of Legends tournaments within the India circuit itself. There are some states that are also trying to fund esport activities in their state. So I think if I recall correctly, Rajasthan government in their budget, the last budget that they came, they had allocated some funds for development of esports in the state. And otherwise as well in Rajasthan, you would see in also in other states like Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, you would see esports centers being developed where participants can come and hone their skills and meet like esports athletes in their areas. As next steps, I think it would be really nice to see initiatives from the central government. Like we have for other sports as well, there's a like BCCI, badminton, football, everyone has a national sports federation. And having that tag gives a lot more legitimacy to the sport itself, like I also spoke about in my discussion. So a national sports federation, which is currently lacking at the central level, would really be beneficial to develop esports in India. And what do we know? Like we may end up having esports in the Olympics and India having a very good shot at it.
Just to add to what Sanjit said. Hello? Can everyone hear me? Yeah, just to add to that, we are seeing some state, at least state level development in terms of policy making with respect to esports. There are federations like Sathak mentioned in some states in India. Tamil Nadu is doing a good job, I believe. But centrally, we still need work. There needs to be a regulatory structure put in place. Again, even internationally, honestly, there is no proper regulatory framework right now. So there needs to be a concerted effort from the industry as a whole to actually make a governance model, form a more uniform system. In India, in the future, I think there is a lot happening right now, and even in the future, we have already seen many big international esports players entering the industry in India. A lot of investment is happening in India. I think with that, also the contractual relationships will develop better. You will have players who are more aware of their rights. You will have teams who will have to also give players more accommodation, more negotiating power. So I think it's a very exciting time for esports, and let's see how it develops. Thanks
so very much, Vishak and Sathak. With that, I'm moving to you, Vidram. There are two questions that I would like you to take. There's one from Gayatri. If a stream publisher, Twitch or Loco or YouTube Gaming allows streamers and viewers to transact through game money, where, you know, maybe I'm tipping to show appreciation or something like that, can game publisher view the same as commercial use and seek any sort of commercial benefit from the publishing stream? That's one question. And there is another one on personality rights. Maybe we've addressed this a little bit as well. Gaming companies, it's interesting that you said gaming companies may use likeness or names of personalities for identification. And in such case, there are lesser chances of claims or damages. So such usage cannot rule out the claims for damages altogether. Is this understanding correct?
Right. Thanks, Neha. So to answer the first question, it would depend on the type of end user licensing agreement that game publishers are entering into with the gamers when they buy the game. So these licensing agreements, these are generally a reflection of the legal approach, so to speak, that game creators or game publishers are taking. So for example, you have companies like Ubisoft and Microsoft who are showing a willingness to work with gamers, who like to encourage game streaming and also encourage the earning of live streamers. On the other hand, you have companies like Nintendo who are very famous for enforcing their rights in this area. And many a times they also force the streamers and the gamers to share the revenue they earn from these platforms with them. But a good example to this question would be how Blizzard Entertainment takes a middle of the road approach to this. So in their end user licensing agreement, they allow gamers to create video content as long as it's freely available without charge. At the same time, Blizzard does allow those gamers to earn partnership revenue from streaming platforms such as YouTube or Twitch. So I hope that answers your question. Moving on to the second question. No, you can't completely rule out the claims of damages, and that's for two reasons. First, in India, there is really no concrete legal guidance on this point, especially on the point of publicity rights and how that is limited, more so in the context of fantasy sports. The principles that I was talking about, the limiting principles, those are derived and extracted from foreign case law. And even in those cases, there remains some ambiguity, because while the judgments allow the use of, there are specific judgments, specific use of player names in fantasy sports context, but there is little clarity if these apply to the use of images or likeness. So while the use of names for identification purposes is allowed, there, in terms of, as I said, in terms of images, the situation is still a little bit more blurry. Yeah, and that's it for mine.
Can we have some closing thoughts from you, 30 seconds wrapping up, before I hand this over to Aman to see as well?
So some closing thoughts. So basically, I think generally, which has been the theme of our research, at least, has been the alignment of intellectual property laws with the gaming world. So at least from what we see, these laws are still a bit older, and they are not best placed to answer some of these new novel problems that are that gaming, so to speak, gaming the emerge in the context of gaming. So yeah, I think this is a good point to start these conversations on how we can reimagine these frameworks to answer better some of these questions.
Perfect. Thank you. Thanks so much, Vijayan. Aman, I'm coming to you. I have our last two questions for the day for you.
Okay.
One, what is the difference in owning a game in DVD and a purchase from stream copy in terms of contractual obligations? That's one. And second is related to the piracy of games. If I'm trying to crack a game and I succeed in cracking it, am I violating their IPR in this case? And also in a case if I am just restricting it to my use, or when I am publicly making it available to other games without charging them any money. So some comment, game piracy.
I can answer both of these fairly quickly. Even if you're purchasing a game through Steam, at the end of the day, what determines your contractual relationship with the game publisher is the end user licensing agreement, the EULA, which we've spoken about at length. I don't think there's much of a difference between those two. I guess if you own a physical copy of a DVD, you do still have that ability to move it around, share it with your friends. But I do think you could maybe share your Steam login with your friend as well and achieve the same result. So the EULA kind of determines everything, so it doesn't really matter where you get a copy of the game from. On the next question, on if you succeed in cracking a game, well, one, number one, you've broken a technological protection measure, which is a violation of Section 65 of the Copyright Act. So that rules it out. On the next question, if you would, so that's violation of that. On the copyright infringement claim, so even a personal copy, I have the act in front of me. A fair dealing with any work not being a computer program for the personal purposes of private or personal use is okay. But this is a computer program at the end of the day. Therefore, this will also amount to infringement. And if you share it further, then that sort of compounds the infringement. I hope that answers it.
So this leads me to my, I wanted to do closing a little bit differently with you. I have two questions on sort of larger zoomed out copyright and IPR and digital gaming. One is, do you think we need to, what's your opinion on our current sort of IP framework when it comes to the world of digital gaming and sports? Does it work? Do we need to overhaul the framework? Do we need a new category for digital games and sports and copyright law? I had a question on fan licenses, which I had put on the chat a little before that. Is that, do we need to look at fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory licensing when we're thinking about the world of esports? So if you could just quick comments as closing comments.
I do agree with what Vijayan said, that there is a need for change. in the existing copyright laws. And a lot of our research actually pointed to like the contributors who go into making a game. Like the Indian Copyright Act has a lot of protection for people who work in the film industry or the music composers and the writers, and making sure they get a share of the revenue. And similar provisions might be like what's actually required for the video game industry to really thrive, to make sure people are equitably paid for their contributions to these games, because they're not the creation of one person. They're like a movie, and they're actually very complex, have a lot of moving parts. So part of the remuneration, how that's shared, royalties, all of that, a lot of it is done contractually as of now, but maybe there's some need for legal changes there. And that FRAND licensing question, I think it's very interesting, especially in like the esports world, where could you think of a game as a standard and therefore like a publisher is obliged, even though it's their intellectual property, to license it to everyone who wants to host a tournament, everyone wants to broadcast these tournaments equally. I think it's a question which might be asked sooner rather than later. And yeah, it's exciting times for this industry, and it's looking forward to what happens.
Likewise, Aman. Thanks so very much. Thank you to you, Aman, and to all of our speakers today for making this a very, very interesting session. I've walked away learning a lot. Thank you very much to all of you that have attended and been very patient with us as we started late while we tried to figure out our technical difficulties. It's been a pleasure having you. Thank you for all of your participation and very, very insightful questions. We are very excited about online gaming and esports. It's a core area of work for us. If you're interested, you'll find a lot of writing about this on our blog. Thank you so much for your time. This was, like I said at the very beginning as well, this was the first of our webinar series. We'll be bringing you lots more of these in the weeks to come. The next one will be next Friday at 3 p.m. Next Friday is the 1st of May. And Aprajita and Arpit will be having a very detailed and animated conversation.
Sorry, it'll be at 5 p.m. 5 p.m. Just to clarify, it'll be at 5 p.m. Yes.
It'll be at 5 p.m. on the 1st of May. And Arpit and Aprajita are going to be talking about all things digital payments. Thank you so very much.
Thank you so very much.
I hope you have a good day. Bye.